Qualitative research is research that involves collecting a large amount of unfiltered data from a relatively small number of individuals and then describing that data using non-statistical techniques. Now, typically, qualitative researchers are less concerned with drawing general conclusions about human behavior than they are with understanding in detail the experiences of those research participants. And qualitative research has its origins in anthropology and sociology, but it has been used in many psychological studies as well. Now, one of the most famous qualitative researchers was Sigmund Freud. He was best known for developing psychoanalysis, and the way he would do his research is like this. So he was primarily a counselor. You know, he would talk to people about their problems. So his clients would come into his office, they'd sit down, and he'd ask them some questions. It was kind of like an informal interview, like a relatively unstructured interview. And he took a lot of notes. And then he would look at those notes at a later time and start to look for patterns. And he noticed certain patterns develop across his numerous patients. And this is how he developed his theories. And he developed a lot of theories. But one of the most influential ones, and one of the ones that has received the most strong scientific support, is Freud's idea that early childhood experiences are incredibly important in shaping our personality and behavior. Like I said, there's a lot of scientific support for that, and that was started by Freud, that whole idea. But other theories Freud had haven't received as much support, if any. Like Freud talked about how the adult personality consists of the id, the ego, and the superego, and the anxieties that we deal with on a day-to-day basis are the result of these kind of unconscious conflicts between these three forces of the psyche. Like I said, we haven't really supported this at all. It's a neat idea, and it has been very influential. And that's kind of the whole point of qualitative research, is to be influential. You know, in a manner of speaking, qualitative research does tend to be pretty neat, but not very useful in a scientific sense. Like, you can't really make generalizations about other kinds of people and other situations, other contexts. You can't do any kind of meaningful statistical analyses in most cases. So all you can really do with a lot of this qualitative research that you might read about is just to come up with new ideas. It's like a starting point. It's a springboard for new fields of research. And Freud was a very influential researcher. He sparked a lot of interest in anxiety and personality and human development and so many other areas that we still are learning about today. Now, if you want to do data collection, you basically would do what Freud did. You'd want to do some kind of interview. This is the most common way to collect data in qualitative research. Now, interviews tend to be unstructured in this kind of research, consisting of a small number of general questions or prompts that allow participants to talk about what is of interest to them. And the research can, of course, follow up those responses by asking more detailed questions about topics that may have come up. Now, this technique is often used by a lot of corporations and businesses nowadays who are maybe, you know, testing a new kind of product or something like that. What they'll do is they'll get a relatively larger number of individuals to interview simultaneously in what we would call a focus group or a focus test. So these are just a group of people who are interviewed together on a particular topic or issue. And while it is interesting and efficient to interview multiple people at the same time, you get the added benefit of seeing how those individuals interact with each other. So if two of your interviewees start arguing about some point, that can be particularly enlightening. So that's one way you could do it. But another way that you could do qualitative research data collection is by doing what's called a participant observation. So this is very similar to a naturalistic observation, but now you're putting yourself into that situation. You're actually becoming a part of the group that you're interested in. And this has some obvious downsides, but it also has some pretty big upsides too. Like with a naturalistic observation, one of the most important things to do there is to kind of blend in and fade away into the background, or literally like hide in the bushes, so you can observe people's behavior without your presence affecting them in some way. But that's only really going to work in a public situation. That's only going to work where there are some bushes, you know, some place to hide, some reasonable way to make your presence not be influential. But if you want to look at more private situations, like if you wanted to see how a particular cult operates, the only real way you could get that kind of information is by joining the cult. So yeah, that's one of the biggest strengths, is that this can be used in situations where naturalistic observations can't. And this can also be used to get special kinds of information. Like if you're in there, if you're in that basement talking to those cult members, you can ask them specific questions and follow-up questions to try to learn more about their behavior and the reasons behind it. And by being in that basement, by, you know, talking to those people, you are going to be getting a particular kind of insight that you wouldn't be able to get otherwise. You know, you're both the participant and the observer in this case, so you can observe yourself, observe your own feelings and your own behaviors and your own thoughts. So yeah, there's some great strengths here. But as I mentioned, the weaknesses are also pretty obvious. Just like a naturalistic observation, this can be very time-consuming. You could spend a lot of time in that cult before you learn anything interesting about them. Or one of the bigger concerns is you could lose your objectivity. You know, this, if you're part of any group, you're going to be affected by them. You're going to start to understand them. Empathy is a natural part of human processing. So when you're in there and you're talking to those people, you're going to start to change your way of thinking. And that can be dangerous in some situations. I keep using the example of a cult, but it's not obviously always just cults. That's just an example. But yeah, if you were investigating a cult, that could be a scary consequence. You might actually, you know, go too far and get stuck, for example. But then there's the third weakness that I have listed here, the high risk of observer influence. Well, that one's pretty obvious. You know, if you're in that room talking to those people, you're going to affect them. They're going to change their behavior in response to you, and that could ruin the whole point of your study. So there's a lot of decisions that need to be made. There's a lot of safety procedures that need to be considered before you go out there and you infiltrate the group that you're interested in and try to learn more about them. But it's not always like these high-stakes situations. It's not always like cults and things like that. Sometimes it's relatively benign. Like here's an example of a famous researcher who wanted to learn more about persuasion. So Robert Levine, he's a big researcher into social influence and obedience to authority and stuff like that. But he wanted to learn the most effective persuasive techniques. So he actually got a job working as a car salesman, and he went through all the same experiences that any other new employee would go through. So he did the training programs, he had like mentors, and he actually sold some cars and things too. So he had the full experience. And what he learned from this is that the most successful salesmen were those that were highly skilled in various persuasive techniques. It wasn't important that they understood why those techniques worked. They just practiced and they mastered those techniques and they learned how to employ them relatively effortlessly. So that's what makes a good persuasive individual, is somebody who has a wide range of tools at hand that they can easily employ to manipulate people. And yes, car salesmen are some of the best persuaders. Just try to keep that in mind the next time you need to buy a car, is these people have all kinds of things that they're going to be using to try to get you to comply. Now, qualitative research obviously has some really good benefits to it. Like you can learn a lot of things that you wouldn't be able to learn otherwise. But there is a lot of debate in the research as to whether this is the best way to go about it. You know, there's a lot of debate between qualitative and quantitative researchers, who tend to be highly critical of their peers' methods. Like qualitative research is often criticized for its lack of objectivity. You know, if you're part of that cult, you're going to lose some objectivity, obviously. Another big criticism is that there's a lot of difficulty when it comes to evaluating your study's reliability and validity, and just the overall lack of generalizability. Like with Sigmund Freud, we might learn something interesting about his patients, but does that really apply to everyone else in the world? It's kind of hard to make that leap in some cases. But then quantitative researchers are often criticized for being too narrowly focused and preferring variables that are more easily quantifiable. In other words, quantitative researchers, they reach for the low-hanging fruit, the easy-to-measure variables, and they might be losing sight of the big picture. They might be missing out on what this construct, this behavior that we're interested in is actually all about, and just measuring stuff that's easy to measure because it's easier. So these debates are always ongoing. I don't think there's ever going to be any resolution to it, but one good thing that has come out of it is kind of a compromise between these two camps. We have developed newer methods now that you could just call combined methods or mixed methods that help to get the best of both types of research while minimizing the risks inherent to each one.